So thank you all for joining us today. Again, my name is Suzanne Lay. I've been working in corporate investment banking in New York City for about 15 years now, and one of my passion projects is working on innovation and financial technology. So I'm really excited to be here to share some interesting conversations with you all about this topic. And I would absolutely invite questions throughout the talk, and hopefully we have some mics around, so if you have a question, please raise your hand and we'll be happy to take your questions. And this panel will be bilingual, so just be a little patient with us as we kind of get through the translation. So really, I have a great all-star panel here who are experts in the industry, and I would love for each of them to do a quick intro of themselves and what their interest is in this space.
Okay, 大家好，我是来自 Fish Solution 的销售总监，我叫 Leo，吴小强。那在加入 Fish 之前呢，我是在欧洲的整个信息服务商 Beryl 公司工作了有8年，做中国区的总经理。那家公司呢，也是在17年的时候被31欧元卖给了穆迪，就这样。
Hi everyone, my name is Kaizhi Tang. I'm head of the technology of Beryl Consulting. I'm working with Fintech for many years. Before, I stayed at Alibaba for 3 years and mainly doing their big data and artificial intelligence application and innovation. Before, I worked in the United States for about more than 10 years, mainly with the US government. Doing a lot of big data and artificial intelligence applications. That's about it.
Right.
So, 大家好，我叫乔立群，来自于哈尔滨银行，是哈尔滨银行金融学会的总监。我在银行业从业已经30年了，前15年呢是在中国建设银行，后15年呢是在哈尔滨银行。期间，哈尔滨银行呢，由我到那时2004年的。 不到3美亿的资产，发展到今年是达到6000多亿的资产。那么，在英国银行家杂志所评选的银行里面排名第207位，在中国呢排名是第34位。那么，哈尔滨银行呢是定位于一家小额信贷的银行，它的发展理念呢就是建设服务先进的，那么就是说全球领先的小额信贷银行。现在呢是在数字化。 引领下吧，向回归金融进行一个全面的转型。那么呢，我们呢在金融科技领域呢，除了自身发展之外呢，还跟百度金融、百度的杜小满呢，在金融科技领域呢开展了全面的战略合作。可以说呢，中国银行业的金融科技呢，也进入了一个全面发展的时代。谢谢大家。
Hi, I'm Robert Ciemniak. I wear a few entrepreneurial hats on here. 7 years ago, I founded Real Estate Foresight. That's a data-driven independent research on China housing markets. And now recently also Robotic Online Intelligence, where we automate market intelligence, focusing on the human consumption of information. And I'm also on the board of directors of China Index Holdings.
Thank you all for your quick intros. To kind of get everybody warmed up, I just want to do a little kickoff question of, since the focus of this particular panel is on the business applications of all of the data and machine learning and artificial intelligence we've been talking about for the past day and a half, I want to get a sense from you as to kind of where you think kind of the current state of a lot of this technology is in sort of business applications. And sort of where do you think the end goal is? Or is there kind of an idea in mind where you think this amazing technology can go in various industries that you're experts in? Whoever wants to jump in. Robert?
I can just jump in. A general comment and observation, which is striking from other conversations, the difference between US and China. When you look at the definitions, for instance, of fintech and what makes it up, in China or even Asia, it's really about payments, and it is about consumer. In the US, it is about enterprise software and data analytics. And the question is whether over time that could fundamentally change and switch and evolve. So is there a massive opportunity in China in enterprise software, for example? So I'd look at some structural shift like that, throw it in.
Anyone else? Okay, 提供一个最后一米的服务。那么在信息端呢，中国所有的银行业在这个信息整合上，首先是做出了比较卓越的。那么我们中国啊，在各大银行呢，它首先把行内的这些个数据信息进行了一个数据的大整合，然后呢，外部从企业弊端的信息，那么进行了一个有效的这个接入。 那么从政府对各类客户的征信信息呢，我们也有一个充分的连接。那么在政府各个部门的政府弊端的这个信息呢，也进行了一个整合，就是说作为我们行嘛，跟他们也都有一定的这样的一个连接。特别是和中国一些个著名的金融科技类的企业，比如说百度啊、阿里啊、腾讯呐，还有京东啊，我们跟他们都有一些个更紧密的这个业务上的合作。 相互之间的信息可以共享，相互之间的客户呢，大家也可以共同的开发。就像我们跟京东啊，跟那个蚂蚁金服啊，和那个和腾讯的微众银行啊，我们也都有相应的这个合作。在这方面呢，就是说中国银行业呢，在大数据这个共享方面呢，取得了一定的成绩。 而从银行内部信息来说呢，首先是信息的这个采集，由于大数据嘛，我们可以采集到更广泛的信息。那么在采集到信息之后呢，要对这些信息进行清理和分类，同时呢，我们要对这些信息呢进行聚类、进行排序，再把这些信息充分整理之后，那么营销前台的他们需要哪些信息，就推送给他们。 那么哪些个对我们的风控跟决策管理具有一定的意义？那么就相应的给哪些部门？所以说各家银行都形成了操作型的客户关系管理系统和这个经营型的吧这种客户关系管理系统。那么通过这些系统呢，我们就可以把信息进行充分的整合。在中国各大银行啊，你包括工商银行，它现在的 ESBC3.0啊，都进行智慧银行管理系统的这样一个全面的升级。所以说呢，中国银行业呢，在大数据跟信息管理上呢，也整体上达到了一个水平，而且呢，它是有中国特色的。在金融科技领域呢，中国银行业也加大了投入的力度。比如说招商银行，它的金融科技每年的投入呢，现在在年报里规定为是上一年的3.5%。
那么就是说，在客户的全景视图吧，和一个客户图谱，以及用它进行金融风控跟管理方面呢，各行也都做到的比较好。我说的大概就是这些。谢谢。Yes, I because
I work mainly for data projects, maybe in different areas. Early, I work mainly with. The government projects, and then later I worked on some e-commerce, mainly from Alibaba, and later I worked on some financial project, data projects. One of the key questions in this area is, we're talking about we have a lot of data, okay? We can connect a lot of data, okay? However, this is a very bad practice, okay? When I was in Alibaba, we did a calculation, okay? If Alibaba cannot turn the data into value, if they cannot make money from the value, Alibaba will be bankrupt immediately. So the most important thing is to how to get value from the data. when we get in the value from the data, I agree. This morning, there's a speaker said about that. Usually, the data science people don't understand the businesses, and the business people don't understand data science, so they cannot work together. So in this way, many data projects just failed. So that's maybe caused a lot of problems. Maybe in this room, I saw many people are from the business side. Okay, so we get very frustrated. So when I was working in these areas, I list out several criteria to evaluate whether a data project will not fail. The first thing is we need to identify the business case. Second, we need to check the data source, whether your data source is there. Next, we need to check whether your data source is valuable, because we may get a lot of data, but many data are useless. There's no value, okay? There's no business connection. And finally, we need to check whether the algorithms is there or not. Finally, we will give you an expectation about your data projects. So I think in this area, in this finance area, or in other area, there are many problems need data to be solved. Not just we want to imagine that data can solve all the problems. Data cannot solve all the problems because your business problem is there. Okay, data can and algorithms can help you to solve the problem. That's my strategy.
我同意 Robert 的观点，就是东方跟西方的那个侧重点是一样的。 比如说在这边支付会多一点，然后在西方那边呢，对公的那部分会多一点。这里面会有很多的历史方面的一些原因吧。那刚才乔先生跟这位先生也介绍了，就是比较多的一些细节。那我想就是特别的一点挑战在，可能在中国这边的信息的透明度，如何去打通现在已有的这些信息之间的这个隔阂是一个关键点。 而在西方那边呢，就是现在有的这些数据如何去处理隐私和相应的这个关系，那是在西方那边的特别。但这个呢，就好像是一个管道，在两边去挖管道，东西方在两边挖管道，其中有一个时间呢，会是有一个最终的一个融合，就是看。
All right, so for the remaining time, we're going to split this into two topics. The first is a use case for digital disruption and revolution using a use case of real estate. And then the second aspect is going to be the China experience. And we have some experts here talking about specifically the China experience. So Robert, if you would do a little chat about real estate and especially your particular interest in the human side of data, I think that's super important as we think about deploying data that we don't lose the human component.
So let me just, if you're less familiar, let me tell you why it's really interesting to look at China property, even if you have nothing to do with that. And you talk to many micro funds and others in the US who look at that sector, because of its size and significance, and how it determines what policymakers do. You know, policymakers respond to the data, they respond to what comes on the market. And China property market, largely China housing market for new homes, is $2 trillion in annual sales last year. The largest developer had contract sales of $100 billion. I think Lennar and the likes in the US are probably 10, 20. So it just gives you a sense of scale, whether you measure by share of GDP, extended share, it's massive. So that's why it's really interesting. But when we now bring it to the data, and I'll pick on something that I think Leo mentioned, the word transparency. I sometimes like to say that, it may shock some of you, I think China is the most transparent market in the world in real estate. I mean, from a certain perspective, let me tell you why. Where else in the world where somebody buys an apartment, like in US language it would be a condo technically, and within 24 hours of that transaction, on a public website of a local government in a tier 5 city, the information is online. It's instant. Right, so now that's an extreme case, of course, but gives you a sense of dynamism. Now, why would the industry of that nature suddenly turned to data and to analytics, where historically you would just make money hand over fist, just buying land in the right place with the right relationships. But a few things changed over the last few years. One, land prices went up through the roof. It's expensive to buy land. And if we play the Vidax music tunes, I would say if you want to understand China property, you just need to look at land. All you need is land. Land is all you need. And supply and demand for land determines the market economics. So that's one factor. The other one is the buyers get more sophisticated. Now it's no longer first-time buyers, it's upgraders. Those people know what they're doing. They'll be more selective, they'll be more particular in what they want. Developers need to really build a quite targeted proposition. It's not quite a commodity market. It matters whether you can do two-bedroom but under 2 million RMB in a particular city. All these factors matter. Financing got tighter. It's very hard to get funding in China unless you're one of the top developers from banks. So with all those factors, from developers' perspective, you suddenly say, oh, well, now the decisions we make in which city we go to, or do we really bid for this land, how quickly we need to execute, you really need to get it right. It's no longer intuition and relationships, and that's where the data comes in. That's why I can tell you in the last few years, there's been a huge move. Everybody and they run more like building data teams and internally, pretty much, to try to analyze the markets. And keep in mind the scale. A major developer might have a few hundred development projects around the country at one particular point in time, typically run by regional teams. Imagine how difficult it may be to even supervise that. But on top of that, all of these generate data itself, themselves. How interesting it can be then to optimize the decision process around that. So we see a lot of, that's kind of the background, but we see a lot of use cases, and not necessarily what we do, but a lot of use cases from the industry driven by those economics. It's economics, it's not some love for data. It's economics and policy that drive that. In terms of the demonstration for the beauty of the data in China property, well, we have a few. One is that we did a little exercise a couple of years ago when we look at anything that could possibly be related to China house prices, which is often the hot topic here. Land sales, sales volumes, new starts, all kinds of other parameters, and we wrote some code to look at any kind of relationship between the data. And the conclusion was that if you wanted to subject it to any scientific review, there was no conclusion, there was nothing you could conclude from that. But if you overlay that with the human knowledge, with the human expertise, how things really work, how to interpret the policy, it was beautiful. It allows us, for instance, subsequently to predict quite well which cities would rise based on data. Like a few years ago, we picked Xi'an as a major performer based on massive drop in land sales, improvement in inventory clearing, improving sales volumes, plus some policy factors, without even going there. And we had repetitively found that if you think of Chinese cities as stocks, you might actually be able to pick the right bits based on cyclicality, based on rotation, based on how the cities go through their cycles. And so that's kind of one aspect. One where you also find interesting kind of potential information edge, the term that was used a few times throughout the day, is local intel. So, you know, in New York Times, you may read one day that there's some easing suddenly happening after previous tightening, right? But often what happens is a local newspaper somewhere in a tier 3 city starts talking about local banks lowering mortgage rates. You need quite a few of those to start happening before, you know, CMP in Hong Kong picks it up and before other papers pick it up or Reuters, Bloomberg write an article about that. So that's a very interesting angle to look at local intelligence. Which is very available, publicly available, but it's very unstructured. And that's when opportunity comes in to come in with technology, to structure it better, to organize it better, to feed it into some frameworks for decisions or insights. So I don't take too much time, but that gives you a bit of a flavor.
No, that's great. No, that's really helpful. I think that you and I were talking earlier about not forgetting the human element to all of this data that we're managing and looking at, being able to utilize the data with the humans and create synergies around that is really important. So thank you so much. We're going to turn our attention now to digital disruption, the China experience, as I like to call it. And I'd like to ask Leo to kind of set the stage for us on digital disruption in China, sort of across industries. Since you work for Fint, you see a lot of different industries, and love to share with the audience a little bit more about kind of how you're seeing that landscape.
谢谢Suzanne。 我只简短讲一些点， 因为我知道在座各位的背景是不一样的， 所以一会儿大家有非常具体的一些问题， 我再更进一步的去展开。 因为我过去的背景主要是跟中国的大型的央企， 就差不多100多家央企里边的前30家， 和200家银行里边的前30家， 然后还有一些政府部门， 比如说中国的国税系统， 那跟这些机构去打交道，所以我讲的经验呢也是关于这部分。那首先呢，我想去讲一下，就是从供应商的角度来去看这些央企和银行有哪些机会。那我觉得这里边最大的一个机会就是一带一路所带动的在海外的这些信息资源的这个机会。 这也是为什么像比如Fish Solution这样的公司，我们拥有在全球的研究实力， 在全球的这种数据，会在中国的像非常多的大型的企业， 还有中央银行， 还有就是比较大的五大国有银行， 他们都会需要这部分。 因为就像刚才Robert讲的， 其实我觉得也很有意思， 有的时候西方看东方是一个看法， 东方看西方是一个看法。 在整个现在的所有的银行， 在国内的信息数据是很容易获得的，但是呢，由于一带一路的这个发展，他们需要拿到非常多的在海外，比如说当地国家的一些情况，存在的一些风险方面的状况，当地行业的一些情况，那在行业里边一些领先公司的一些情况，以前的做法都是通过咨询公司，但是世界发展太快，为什么说数据科技我们大家非常重视呢？ 因为现在一切都是数据流，一切都是数据流，所以尤其是当涉及这种跨国的生意，涉及到一些审批，你只是单纯请一个咨询公司去做一个结果出来，可能到你真正要完成一个收购是需要3个月到半年以后，而且股票市场也在发生变化，大宗商品市场也在发生变化，所以我当时咨询的那个结果呢，在你真正去购买的时候呢，都可能已经不适用当时的那个情况。 所以如何用一个系统把所有的这些信息能够做一个实时的一个监控，那在你整个的项目发展的周期的过程当中，随时能够去制定一个决策，这个无论是在中国的大型的企业，还是在大型的银行，都是一个关键点吧。我就先讲这一点，因为待会儿大家感兴趣，任何主题我可以更进一步的再讲。
Thank you so much, I really appreciate that. Again, if people have questions, please raise your hands and we'll be happy to entertain questions at any time. So last couple of panels, we want to keep it lively. Kaizhi, you're my expert on inspiring a generation of leaders to take on innovation. And I'd love to hear some experiences that you've had on innovation and how we could think about inspiring leaders to take on innovation.
Yeah, I continue my talk before. In the last few years, I mainly work on the internet companies. So a good thing about internet companies is data is lateral. So and also he has a fast way to turn the data into value. I'll just give you an example. It's a famous example when I was working at Alibaba. Many people using Taobao and the application. When you search a product, you will find a series of similar products. Okay. So this kind of application was developed by a data mining person. It's my colleagues. Basically, when he do data analysis, he observed when a person who click the same type of or same type of product with some similar properties 7 times, the conversion rate will skyrocket.
okay, will be increased a lot. So he based on this analysis information, then he developed this product. So basically when you click one product and you will see a lot of series, a lot of similar products. So when these things came out, on that year, the sales of Taobao doubled. So this person get 20 months of salary as a bonus of this tech year. I just want to give you an example as how this data can really turn into value. It's because when the data is close to the business scenario, it's close to the money, okay, the value of the data can be really generated. So in my experience, I saw a lot of such opportunities. So before, when I was working with Beryl early days, and we developed Beryl tools. In Beryl tools, and we crawling and getting a lot of information about some policies, some farms, and we can analyze this data, and this data will become structured. When the data becomes structured, they can combine with the quantitative data and to make predictive models or machine learning models. So this is usually a good way. Right now, happens in many industries, in many applications. So it's trying to merge the text data or natural language processing data into the quantitative models. Another way in these days, and another project I worked is I try to analyze all the comments from Taobao's buyers and also from AliExpress buyers. So using these comments, we can get the sentiments, and the sentiments will help two sides. One side is will drive more sales, because from other people say this is a good product, and we list out, and more people will come to buy. At the same time, this information can be very useful for analyzing the shops and to diagnose whether you perform well or not. So this is another case we can use the text information to help decision making, this kind of things. So I saw more and more things is we are trying to utilize more and more data, especially unstructured data. Before, we may ignore them because the algorithms or the processes cannot deal with those data. But these days, it's very easy to take them into account into your application. I think this is a very good news. So, these days, even people are trying to, we are trying to analyze the voice data and even video data. Okay? From there, we can get a lot more information. The things is, I think from the finance perspective, from the decision making perspective, before we only focusing on some information that we are familiar and all the people are focusing on this information, then the alpha cannot be generated easily. So, but if you are taking other information, for example, you're taking the information not easy to be understood or data cannot easy to be analyzed, and also there are so many, we call it alternative data, it's so many other dimensions we can take into the consideration. So that will really improve the performance or building from the other dimensions, building very good performance and applications.
Excellent, thank you so much. So Mr. Charlie Chun, I would love to hear very succinctly about some more of your expertise on innovation in financial services. As we've heard before, that there are so many applications. Having been in financial services for a long time myself, I'm very interested to hear about the China experience in innovation.
中国金融业啊，特别是中国银行业，经过这些年的发展，到2018年末，它的总金融资产已经达到了260万亿。
而现在也从高速发展吧，向高质量发展来转型。那么中国银行业从2018年的经营跟2019年的转型来看呢，它明显存在着这样几个特点。第一呢，是向集团化和综合化转型。那么中国的大型银行集团呢，基本上都是全牌照的，那么这里就是各种的 license 这些大的集团都有。那么这样的话呢，它就形成了一点接入，那就是不管是你从银行接入，还是从信托接入，还是从保险接入，那么呢这个交叉销售就开始了。由于中国的监管，特别是现在利率下降是一个必然的趋势，所以说中国银行业呢要想保持一个利润的增长，靠传统的利差已经是不可能的了。所以说就是一定是要商业银行加上投资银行，这样进行双轮驱动，进行综合化的这个这种转型吧，才能达到这样的一个目的。第二呢，就是金融科技，这个呢在中国叫做科技赋能，赋予它的能量和能力吧。那么通过这种金融科技赋能呢，一是提高了效率，特别是在前端，通过大数据呢，我们能把一些个各类客户的数据都整合给营销的这些个团队。那么呢，以前按照28理论呢，是20%的优质客户为银行创造80%的收益。那么现在呢，这些个长尾的这些80%的中小客户，那么也开始为银行呢贡献出一个更大的一个利润。因为呢，通过大数据的深度挖掘和分析，能够精准的分析这些个客户需求什么，那么我们银行的卖点是什么。我在这里给大家举一个简单的例子啊。我的儿子今年25岁，他在那个北京呢，就是说一家银行是一个渠道经理，他们是一家银行，但是他们这个金融集团呢又有保险，又有信托，又有证券。那么呢，他每天所忙的就是在这些家金融机构之间来跑，那么看保险公司的那些个客户需要哪些个银行的产品，看呢就是说银行这个客户有没有股票账户托管和开户，还有有没有要买保险理财保险资管，还有一些个信托的一些个资管怎么样跟银行对接。这样的话呢，这个高度的综合化呢和金融科技就结合起来了。因为当他每天把他那个客户关系管理系统打开的时候，他就应该知道他这些个他所要服务这个区域现有的客户，下一步需要就是说哪些个金融产品，然后呢根据它的经营任务，那么潜在的哈，就是这个区域还有哪些个客户可以发展，比如说就是说保险公司那边的客户，他们怎么样去营销，这个是一方面。第三方面呢，就是说轻型化管理啊，已成为一个整个的一个趋势，就是中国银行业呢，已经向轻资产、轻资本和轻管理这个程度来转型了，就是以前靠规模、靠网点、靠依赖资本的快速扩张的时代呢，已经向效能提高的时代来进行转型了。第四呢，就是说在中国政策的传导下呢，中国的普惠金融大大的发展了。我们知道中国的几乎就是说所有的全国性的股份制银行吧，还有那个大型的国有银行都成立了普惠金融事业部，这样全面为中小微和民企业进行服务。在这种前提下呢，首先就是利率的一个下降，所以说全球呢利率下降呢，近期也应该是一个主流的趋势。那么下一点呢，那就是说吧，就是说在普惠金融的这个前提下呢，那么银行的经营啊，监管更加规范了。那么特别是我们的投行同业，在强监管的前提下呢，在逐步的缩表。那么就是说呢，在这种情况下呢，非标资产转成标准化资产呢，那么是有时间限制的。那么未来呢，资产证券化的这个市场呢，会有一个较大的发展。对不起，我再看一下啊。另外呢，就是说去年跟今年呢，就是说中国银行业向零售业的转型是非常明显的，整个大零售几乎成为各家银行转型的一个重点。那么包括平安银行吧，它去年零售资产呢增速也是非常快的，也是实现了一个零售转型。像我们行呢，坚持哈尔滨银行啊，坚持以零售业务为主已经十几年了。 我们的中小微零售业务呢是占比是超过60%，接近70%的。这样的话呢，就是说通过这种综合化的管理，通过科技的赋能，那么再通过创新呢，中国银行业呢也进一步的就是说转型发展。在未来金融开放的前提下呢，我们将更加拥抱全球吧，也欢迎国际各类级金融资本吧，就是说投资我们国内的这个商业银行，大家呢共同享受中国经济。虽然现在进入一个中高速的发展吧，但是说如果中国经济能保持5-6%的这个发展速度呢，那么在10年之内嘛，我们的 GDP 还是可以翻番的。同时呢，在5G 人工智能时代呢，就是说中国的银行业在金融创新上呢，也是在主动的转型，所以说它取得的一些成绩呢，也是不足为奇的。
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed your discussion about financial inclusion. I think that it's a very important topic for banks to continue to pursue is financial inclusion. So thank you so much for that discussion. Definitely would love to open up the mics for some questions. But certainly, one thing that I want to kind of fast forward while we're waiting for some questions, if anyone has any. If we were to sit here 5 years from now, what would your various industries look like in terms of disruption? It seems to be happening so fast. Where do you think it is going if we were here 5 years from now? Where do you think we would be? Robert?
So I'm both in a number of them, but from real estate industry perspective, I think it won't be that different because it will go through the cycles as it had in the last 10 years, and cycles matter. But there will be just more data, more analytics, but nothing revolutionary. On the automation and data side, there's one topic I want actually to link to what Tang was talking about when you deal with data and looking for the edge and everybody else get that data and then you look for the next alternative data. The other path around that is around customization, but not customization in terms of interfaces and so on, but rather customization to the view of the world, which is really unique to a specific company or hedge fund or investor. Because often when you see data that are meant to represent signals, somebody somewhere defines the classification, defines what makes a signal. But what if you could, as the end user, really define it to your specific context? And I think we're betting on that being much more about that, because then your edge is a combination of data and your brain capacity, not just what somebody gives you.
Why don't we jump to Leo? What do you think? Where is the China industry going in 5 years? So your crystal ball.
对未来的预测永远都是非常困难的，因为任何一个微小的事件出现的话，你所有的预测都会被打变。改变，但是我觉得就是持续性的预测是很关键的。比如说像我们的研究方法里面，我们每个季度会对各个国家然后一些主要的行业会有对他们未来10年的一个预测，然后我们每次都是滚动预测。这个滚动预测讲什么呢？之前我们的预测是什么，然后现在哪些情况我们是坚持的，哪些情况有变化了，当前的情况是什么样，然后我们站在今天这个时点对未来的这个看法是什么样子。我想整个世界现在的速度会变得越来越快，因为所有的实体经济任何事情都被在数据化，而数据又在 online， 所有在线上的这些信息包括分析，以前纯靠人脑的这种方法论现在变得越来越多，你可以用 AI 的科技去做。那包括像回域标普穆迪，大家也都在比如说在数据方面，然后在 AI 方面，就像军备竞赛一样，穆迪30亿美金收购比亚迪，就是可以拿到全球超过几家公司的资产负债损益等等很多的信息。那如果大家注意的话，在去年标普也是1亿美金收购了一家算法很强的公司，这个公司的那个算法在一定程度上可以替代分析师。 那在过去的这些年呢 ，Fitch 也在持续购买一些公司，也在IT 方面投入非常多的一些力量。就是我们希望加强我们传统已有的优势，同时把我们的一些新的优势能够去发挥出来，然后给客户带来更大的价值。
谢谢。All right,
Kaizhi. I'm not a micro guy, but a micro guy. So I observe two areas. One is this automotive area, auto data area. I'm thinking maybe more and more automotive data. Thousands of additional dimensions of data will bring into this investment area. So I think be more and more alternative data models will be generated. This is one part. The other part I want to talk a little bit about the retail industry. Retail industry will have one trend. Before, like Amazon and Alibaba, I called they built a nice platform and tool to support what we call the rational sales. So basically, we compare price, we compare properties, we compare pictures. Okay, this is you can stay there and think for a long time and try to purchase your product. I think in the next few years, this area is called affection sales. That means based on your emotion, based on your psychology movement, many purchases will happen that way. This will be driven by a lot of technology. For example, emotion detection, face recognition, and voice recognition. And all this information will feed into the tool, and the tool will analyze the underlying of this person and will recommend the right product for you. So that's two tiny areas.
That sounds very dangerous for my future shopping needs. So thank you so much. Mr. Chaliqun, where is banking and financial services going in 5 years? If I come back here, what will be exciting for you in our last 2.5 minutes? Thank you, sir.
用三句话说吧，不用2.5，就是科技啊，会使银行业的效率更加高效，可以使它的服务呢更加精细化，可以使它为每一个客户呢更加精准化，提供一种差异化的全面的服务。那么金融科技呢，它可以给我们带来大量的数据，但是说呢，数据的真实性，你的决策还是要靠人来使用。大数据能提高我们银行业和整个金融业务的效率，但是最终呢还需要人来完成。那就是说呢，从线上获取海量的数据，线下呢有一个强大的一个营销队伍，去跟每个客户呢进行一对一的顾问式的这种亲密的接触。这样的话呢，线上线下双轮驱动，使金融呢为客户提供更加便利、更加精准，而且更加高效的个性化的和具有中国特色的服务。我想这个是未来5年后中国银行业必然走的一条道路。那么阿里巴巴、蚂蚁金服，他们颠覆了中国的支付结算，形成了金融科技的领先。那么呢此消彼长，但是中国银行业也会迎头赶上。毕竟我们拥有最大的客群、最大的金融资产，也有最好的风险管理能力。最后说呢，金融的本质就是管理风险，用管理风险来积极性盈利，而风险的来源就是信息。这样呢说呢，就是金融科技是为我们提供了更广泛的信息，供我们来选择，供我们来使用，供我们来决策。谢谢大家。
Thank you so much. We have about 30 seconds left. Any final thoughts from the panel?
I would just say, don't forget the human aspect in your with all those algorithms around. Are you really in control? What you're feeding yourself with? Consider that.
All right, great. Thank you guys so much for your participation, and we'll hopefully be back in 5 years to see what happens next.